Welcome! In this video, I will show you how to create this starry sky pattern in SVG. This pattern can be described as a number of random white dots or points on a black background. In the end, we will be able to create variations of it by simply altering an integer within the code. Let's get started! Here, I have my development environment. On the left side is the code editor, and on the right side is the preview for the SVG. First, let's add the SVG tag. Then specify the XML namespace. It is required to use this exact URL, which might be hard to remember. You can look it up anytime on the internet by searching for SVG namespace, or you can just read it from the video. As you can see on the right side, our image is blank. That's because we don't have any graphic elements in the SVG yet, so let's add a rectangle. A rectangle is defined by the rect tag, and by default its width and height are 0. Let's set them to 100% so it will fully cover the viewport. And now our image became black. Our rectangle is filled with the default black color because we didn't specify a fill color. In order to achieve the starry sky pattern, we will have to add a filter. We can define a filter by using the filter tag. Let's add the filter before the rect element. Then we will also specify its ID. Let's pick a straightforward identifier. For example, we can just name it filter. We can apply a filter on an element by referencing its ID in the filter attribute of the element. Referencing is done with the help of the so-called URL functional notation. This means the value of the filter attribute on our rect will be URL open parenthesis hashtag filter closing parenthesis. Now we see our image is blank again. That's because our filter doesn't do anything. So let's build our filter. A filter consists of one or more filter effects. SVG has more than a dozen filter effects. They all start with the letters FE, which stand for filter effect, but they are also known as filter primitives. The first filter effect we are gonna add is the turbulence filter effect. The turbulence filter effect generates a Perlin noise pattern. The Perlin noise is a gradient type of noise which has an organic feel, contrary to the more commonly known white noise, which is just pure randomness. In order to generate some noise, we have to specify the base frequency attribute. The base frequency controls the frequency of the noise, so a higher frequency means more noise and a lower frequency means less noise. In my experience, the practical range for it is between 0 and 1. Let's start by setting this value to 0.01. Now we can see some interesting noise pattern on the right side. It seems as if there is a glowy upper layer and a colorful one below that. Technically, 4 layers of noise are generated, one for each color channel and a fourth one for the opacity channel. The color channels being red, green, blue, and the opacity channel being the alpha. The alpha channel has some parts that are fully transparent. These parts seem to be glowing, but they are really just letting through the blank background. Let's play around a little with the value of the base frequency. As I gradually increase it, the image becomes more and more noisy. Let's see what happens if I set it to a really low number, like 0.001. And now, let's slowly increase it. It pretty much seems like as if we are zooming out of the image. And I indeed think of this value as a control of zoom level. Let's keep the base frequency at 0.01 for now. We have some noise, but we are still very far from the starry sky. Let's add another filter effect to modify this noise. We're gonna add a color matrix filter effect. Let's set up its 4x5 matrix with zeros. When a filter consists of multiple filter effects, they are chained together. So the output of the turbulence filter effect becomes the input of the color matrix, and the output of the color matrix filter effect becomes the result of the filter. The color matrix filter effect operates in the linearized RGB color space. This is a different color space than the one used in CSS and practically all over the web. But we don't need to dive into all the specifics of these differences. All we need to know for this video is that the color value per channel is float and goes from 0 to 1. 0 being the lowest intensity of the color and 1 being the highest intensity of the color. The color matrix filter effect receives an input image and executes an operation on all of its pixels, producing new pixels that define a new image as output. How it modifies pixels can be described as a matrix multiplication. That's why it's called color matrix. But we don't necessarily need to know matrix multiplication to use this filter effect. It's much easier to understand how the output value is calculated per channel, which goes like this. Take the channel values of the input pixel, multiply each of them with an assigned weight, then take the results of the multiplications and sum them up along with some constant offset. Consider only the first row of the matrix. It has 5 values. These are 5 weights, which influence the value of the red channel of the output pixel. The values of the first row will be passed to this equation, where RO is the red output, WR, WG, WB, WA are the weights for each channel, C is a constant, and RGBA are the channel values of the input pixel. Let's pretend our matrix looks like this. Then the equation becomes this. So for each pixel, we take the red input, multiply it by 0.1, take the green input, multiply it by 0.2, take the blue input, multiply it by 0.3, take the alpha input, multiply it by 0.4, then sum the results of these multiplications and add 0.5 to it. One of the simplest operations we can do is the identity operation. In case of the red channel, this means we keep the red value as it is. We can achieve this by making the first weight 1 and setting the others to 0. With these values, our equation looks like this. So we cancel out the inputs of the G, B, A channels because we multiplied them by 0, and only this 1 multiplied by R remains, making the red output the same as the red input. The second, third, and fourth rows work the same way, but their outputs are the values of the green, blue, and alpha channels respectively. So let's define an identity matrix that passes through the input image as it is. Here we are passing through the red value, then here the green value, then the blue, and finally the alpha value. And as you can see, we have the same noise pattern as before we added the color matrix. Now let's play a bit with the values of the matrix. For example, let's set the value of the alpha channel to constant 1, so the image doesn't have any transparent parts. Then let's see what happens when we clear these ones. Now we only pass through the red channel, making our image red and black. Let's take the red input and pass it to the green output as well. Now our image is yellow and black. That's because we have the same value for the red and green channels per pixel, resulting in the yellow hue. Let's do this for the blue channel as well. So now our image is grayscale. In a sense, we are getting closer to the starry sky, because that is a grayscale image as well. Having played a lot with the turbulence filter effect, I noticed that the noise on the alpha channel is much smoother. So let's move these ones to the column of the alpha channel. This image is very bright, and we need to create a night sky. Let's try to bring the brightness down. We approach that by simply subtracting some constant value from the color channels. Let's do minus 0.5 for a start. We end up having some grayish blobs. We want to make these blobs smaller, so they better illustrate the distant stars. If you remember, we can zoom out by altering the base frequency. Let's see what happens if we increase this value to 0.02 or 0.03 or 0.05. We can go all the way to 0.1 maybe, or even 0.2 should look nice. And we are kind of having the starry sky pattern. The only difference from what I've shown in the intro is that in this image the stars are a bit darker. Let's try to make them brighter by changing some values in the matrix. If we double these ones over here to increase color intensity, we should end up having brighter stars. However, as a side effect, we created some more stars. Let's try to compensate this by subtracting one in the last column. We can further tweak these values to see how this matrix works. With 5 and minus 3, we have much fewer stars. When I created this pattern, I ended up with 9 and minus 4. With these values, there are quite a lot of stars on the sky, and they are pretty bright. In the beginning, I promised you a way to create variations of this pattern. We are gonna use the seed attribute of the turbulence filter effect for that. Let's set the seed attribute to 1 on the feTurbulence tag. The seed attribute sets the seed value for the random number generation used by the noise generator under the hood. Its default value is 1, but if we change this to 2, we will see a different pattern. Or let's try 3, 4, 5. Even bigger numbers work. With this single attribute, we can create millions of variations of this pattern, but I like to keep things simple and just use the default value. So let's remove this attribute altogether. One last thing I wanted to show you is the size of the file. We can see that it is only 10 lines of code, but we can further minify it by removing the extra white space and shortening the ID. I'm gonna open up this terminal here, and I use this utility called SVGO. SVGO is a Node.js tool for optimizing SVG files. I had installed it earlier on my machine. I just have to pass the SVG file as the first argument, and by default, it will overwrite it with the optimized version. It prints the result of the minification, which turns out to be 223 bytes. And that's how you create a starry sky pattern that fits in a tweet. You can check out the code following the CodePen link in the description. Thanks for watching, and see you next time!